things that probably people in differential algebra haven't seen yet. I'll speak about differential Galois theory, but also about difference Galois theory, because basic topic will be also some difference, linear difference operators. And now, if I just remind you this very famous non-linear differential equation, which is the KDD equation for a real function of real variable u, just depends on x and it also depends on time. It was a fundamental discovery which was made here in New York in Courant Institute by Professor Peter Lux, that there is an associated linear operator, and it's basically the phase space for the KDD equation may be identified with the space of second order differential operators on the line, or Schrödinger operators on the line. And what's more important, this non-linear differential equation, which is has many integrals of motion, they commute to the structure of natural Poisson bracket. And the discovery of this Poisson structure, which is compatible with this non-linear equation, is, has been a very important part of the story. And there exists, in fact, several Poisson structures which are related to this equation, and I shall mainly deal with the most trivial one, which is Poisson-Virasoro algebra. We can't identify, just we have this very famous operator L, which is d minus d squared to dx squared plus u of x. This is the Schrödinger operator, and the space of the Schrödinger operators may be phase space. Space is the dual of a Lie algebra. And this famous Lie algebra is the so-called Virasoro algebra. This is the central extension of the Lie algebra of vector fields on the line or on the circle, depending on the boundary conditions which you choose. And this is a very important point that you can identify when when you change variables in this operator. This is a diffeomorphism of the line, and then the Poisson, this Schrödinger operator, transforms like it should be for the coadjoint representation of this central extension of the Lie algebra vector field, Virasoro algebra. And this Virasoro algebra plays a very important role, and moreover, spectral invariants of this operator, they generate integrals of motion for this KDD equation, and all these quantities of motion commute with respect to the Poisson bracket, which is just the standard Lie Poisson bracket associated with with our Virasoro algebra. And now, if we just look at this equation, minus d squared plus dx squared plus u of x psi equal to zero. It's a very natural idea in differential algebra to consider the solutions of this Schrödinger equation, or just speaking algebraically, it's a Picard-Vaisseau your extension of the differential field generated by the potential. And of course, from the point of view of differential Galois theory, the situation is not very interesting, because I just consider generic potentials, and so then the differential Galois group will be just SL2. But now, here comes the question. Is it possible to extend the Poisson bracket, which is already known for the potentials, to the space of wave functions? And this innocent question appears to be...
It's a wave function of C. C is a wave, called a wave function.
Yes, psi is the wave function. I just use this terminology, which comes from physics, because it's just the Schrödinger equation, and so the solution is called the wave function. There are two independent solutions of this equation, and they just generate this Picard-Vissieux extension of the differential field generated by U. The question is how to extend the Poisson bracket, and you see it's easy to compute the potential once you know the wave function, and I'll come up to this classical formula, which goes back to Schwarz, but not the other way about. So we have a mapping which goes from psi to u, and the Poisson bracket, it's a tensor which transforms just in the direction of the arrows. So it's not elementary to lift the Poisson bracket from u's to psi's. This is the core of the difficulty. And you can think that it's impossible just to go in the opposite direction to the natural arrows. And the answer is non-trivial. You can do it, but in a not quite canonical way. And in so doing, some part of the symmetry is broken. You can just, we must make some choices which are a priori not quite canonical, which we should review to be canonical finally, after imposing extra natural conditions. And as a result, some symmetries are broken, and the Poisson bracket which we get for psi is not invariant with respect to the action of the differential Galois group, rather is covariant. And this is a new axiom which has been first studied by Drinfield and on the following the first and very profound examples found by Sklianin, who worked in our group in Leningrad at the time. And this kind of symmetry breaking is what I'm going to tell. So just let me recall that you have just two solutions of this Schrödinger equations, just two elementary wave functions. And the Wronskian of a pair of solutions, say phi and psi, is constant. And we can regard this pair of solutions as a curve with values, say, in C2 or in R2, depending on the field of coefficients which you prefer. The group, if you have this vector phi psi, then we have, of course, this phi psi g with g SL2. So they can take a different basis in the space of solutions, and this change of basis is described by this matrix with which also preserves the Wronskian, because the determinant is 1. And we can also look at this thing projectively. Just we can suppose, since the curve is non-degenerate, which means that this wedge product, it's nowhere 0. Then we get this projective curve. If we just simply, just in elementary terms, we can just consider phi psi as homogeneous coordinates, but if we just take the quotient, then we get an affine model for this projective curve with values in CP1 or in RP1, this affine part corresponds just to the zeros of the second component psi. And then from this curve, you can also reconstruct the potential. And this is the classical formula which goes back to Schwarz. And it just says just 1/2 of the Schwarz derivative of this function eta. And of course, due to the basic properties of the Schwarz derivative, it's projective invariant, as it should be, because if you just change the basis in the space of solutions, then your eta undergoes this fractional linear transformation, and u remains there. And now let's look again at the Schrödinger equation. It's included into a family of integrable PDEs, which are all associated with this SO2 group and its subgroups. And first of all, we can write the so-called Schwarz PDE equation, which is holds for the function eta itself. And so it's an integral and again an integrable equation, and if it is satisfied, then for the Schwarz derivative itself satisfies the KdV equation, of course, so it's a compatible thing, and we get this rather interesting diagram. Just at the top of the tower we have this Schwarz-KdV equation, then we have equation for this. We make a series of compatible differential substitutions, with the rho being the logarithmic derivative of eta, and tau being just the ordinary derivative, and all these differential substitutions, they are compatible with dynamics, and for each function we just get its own nonlinear differential equations. They are all compatible with each other and all compatible with the Schwarz-KdV at top of the tower, and the ordinary KdV at the bottom. Now we can just look at this picture from the point of view of differential Goulart theory, and this was the point of view which was first advocated by George Wilson in late 1980s. So we just consider the differential field generated by these two solutions, and the SO2 group is just the differential Galois group of this extension, and we take different subgroups. This center, the split Cartan subgroup, the triangular unipotent subgroup, the Borel subgroup, and so each extension, here it is, each subfield of invariance is in itself a free differential algebra generated just by a single function. This is eta, rho, theta, v, and finally u, which is just the Schwarz derivative of eta. And so we have a very nice picture. Everything is compatible, and everything is also compatible with dynamics. If we just include dynamics, just on each level of this tower of extension, you have its own dynamics. And there is one single question which hasn't been properly resolved by George Wilson in his time. How to reconcile this tower and this commutative diagram with Poisson bracket? Presumably, we have to define a Poisson bracket for each at each level of the tower, and then the Hamiltonian is evident, because the Hamiltonian can be lifted up from the bottom of the tower, following the natural direction of the arrows. So there is no problem with choosing the Hamiltonian, but there is a problem with choosing a correct Poisson bracket. Wilson, in his paper, well, of course, he understood that he cannot deal with Poisson brackets because they transform in a wrong direction. He opted for symplectic form, which transforms properly. But there are also, it's not flawless, because of the boundary conditions, the symplectic form, or the degenerate two form which he defined, is not actually closed. And as a result, the Jacobi identity for this associated Poisson brackets becomes non-evident. So there are, this is another manifestation of the same problem of this fancy symmetry break into which I'm now going down. And here comes the answer. This Poisson bracket, well, just somehow we just guessed the answer, imposing some natural conditions on the choice of this Poisson bracket. Here is the answer which we got with Jan Marshall a few years ago. Just let me explain the notation. We can just, the values of these wave functions, psi 1 and psi 2, can be regarded as functionals defined on our differential algebra generated by psi. So just a Poisson bracket of two such functionals is again a function of x and y, and it also includes this key ingredient, the kernel of certain linear operator, which is called classical R matrix. Well, psi 1 and psi 2 are just two component vector functions, because we have two component, just two independent solutions. So the indices 1 and 2, they just refer to two copies of this vector space C2, and over just the left hand, the right hand side is therefore a vector in C2 tensor C2, and R is a it's a distribution, it's a kernel of a distribution in the Schwarz, Laurent Schwarz sense, which lives in with values in C2 cross times tensor products with C2, and here is the result. It includes two step functions, which are just the Schwarz kernels of the integration operator, and two classical R matrices, R plus and R minus, which are well known in the theory of Poisson Lie groups. And if we just
it's a classical small
R. It's a classical, yes. I use this big letter, which should not be confused with the full quantum R matrix, which doesn't appear in my talk. It's just, it remains behind the scene. And if we just postulate this Poisson bracket, it's okay. It's a perfect Poisson bracket. The Jacobi identity holds. And we can then use all these differential substitutions which were listed in my one of my previous transparencies, eta, theta, v, etc. And we can just compute the Poisson bracket for all these functions. And here they are. And finally, for u, for the potential itself, we just get the correct formula. Here it appears for the first time explicitly. This is the in one of the equivalent forms, this is the famous Poisson-Virasoro bracket with which I referred before. Again, the Poisson operator in itself is just if we just compute the Poisson bracket of this evaluation functionals which evaluate the values of potential just at x and at y, then the right hand side is a distribution, and this is what we get. So finally, I can claim that this is the correct answer. I have properly defined the Poisson bracket just at the top of the tower of extensions, and then by descending down, I just get subsequently all these formulas. Just let me show them again. And finally, I reconstruct the formula which we knew from the very beginning, which gives the correct Poisson bracket for the potentials. So in a sense, I have won. Although, of course, I didn't explain how does it come about and why do we get this fancy symmetry breaking
with this, the symmetry breaking is associated with these two classical R matrices, R plus and R minus.
Now just let me write the axiom, which is replaces the simple invariance of the Poisson bracket in this case. Well, in ordinary Hamiltonian mechanics, we have a manifold M and an action of the group G into M, which preserves Poisson brackets. And then this is the usual situation, the classical symmetry in classical mechanics. Then the group itself doesn't carry any Poisson bracket at all, and the Poisson bracket on our manifold is invariant. And as a result, we get Noether theorem and many things which are known from the textbooks. So this simple theorem is replaced by a different one. This time, G itself is a Poisson manifold, such that the multiplication map is a Poisson map, which is non-trivial. This means that, well, if you have just phi and psi of G1 times G2, we must compute the Poisson bracket in the product, in the point which is a product of the two. So we can just do it in two ways. First, we just compute it as a bracket of two variables and then insert as an argument just the product. It's psi 1 psi 2 g for g equal to g1 over g2. This is the trivial way. Or we can regard it as a function of two variables, phi of g2 psi of, so it's a plus phi of g1 point psi g1 point, and then this point is equal to g2. So in this setting, we just suppose that our function depends on two independent variables, g1 and g2, so we compute the bracket with respect to g1, taking g2 as a parameter, as a redshift, and plus the same thing for g2, where we this time we use g1 as a left shift parameter. And so this sum of two brackets of functions of two variables is equal just to the single value of the same bracket evaluated for the product point.
So you just want to say that the homomorphism of polytonic Poisson algebra?
Yes, yes. So this is this mapping is a Poisson mapping, which means that it's a non-trivial property that you have functions of two variables and their bracket is the same as the bracket computed with only a single variable, and then you just make evaluation at the product point. This axiom characterizes the Poisson-Le groups, and then of course you have this extra axiom in this category of Poisson groups and Poisson manifolds. This is again a Poisson map, which again means that there is a correction term that when you compute the bracket for transform functions, you must take into account the contribution of the bracket on G. And I just claim that the Poisson bracket, which I get in this way, it is not invariant with respect to the action, to the right action of the of SO2, which is the differential Galois group in this case. The symmetry is explicitly broken. It is broken due to the presence of these matrices, and this little R matrix, R plus and R minus, they are not arbitrary, of course. They define the standard Poisson structure in SO2 group, which has been known for decades. It's just the starting point of the whole theory of Poisson group. This elementary but highly elementary example of a Poisson structure on this SO2 group. And now, of course, you can I tell you the truth, but you may be not satisfied with that answer. I must give an explanation. How does it come about? Where does it come from? And why? Finally, the result is more or less rigid. Just to make the situation more transparent, we have to do several steps. First, we replace second-order differential operator by first-order matrix differential operator, and there is a well-known chapter of the theory which explains how to do it via Hamiltonian reduction. This is the famous Drinfeld-Sokolov theory. And also we must, it's very helpful just to replace differential equations with difference equations. And so if we just look at it in this way, so the first order differential equation is nothing but a covariant derivative in some vector bundle over the real line or over the circle. Difference operator may be interpreted as a parallel transport operator in that same fiber bundle, vector bundle. And wave functions, they are covariantly constant sections of this vector bundle. And again, we can just start ask this this question. How to lift the Poisson structure which lives on the space of coefficients, on the space of potentials, on the space of connections, better say, in this geometric relation, to the space of these sections? And again, the answer is non-trivial. Now we have two groups which act on wave functions or on these sections. We can just transform them on the left, and this is the famous gauge group, which transforms simultaneously the sections and the connections. So we have this. Goes to g psi, and if so, the abstract setting is this: we just take an algebra equipped with an automorphism tau, and we look at this difference equation. The transformed function is proportional to the original one, and so this L is then equal to psi tau psi to the minus one. The fundamental solution of this difference equation just gives you the potential. And if we just make a gauge transformation of this kind, then simultaneously L goes into g tau Lg to the minus 1, and this is the difference gauge transformation. And there is also another action, psi goes into psi h, the right action, and if h is a quasi-constant, if h equal to h tau, then of course the equation doesn't change, and the potential L doesn't change at all, and the difference below a group is a subgroup of this group of right translations. This is common point. So this is the summary of what I have already said. There are just two natural realizations of this abstract scheme. We can just consider functions on the lattice, and tau acts as a lattice translation, or we can consider functions on the line, and tau acts just as a
finite translation on the line, or we can just consider meromorphic functions in punctured plane, and then the automorphism term just acts by as a this dilatation or dilation operator, which is well defined in this punctured plane. And then we have quasi constants, which in the first case these are just genuine constants on the genuine constants which are live on the lattice. Here these are periodic functions with period one, and here these are elliptic functions which live on an elliptic curve. And now we must define a Poisson structure. And here comes a rather unfamiliar chapter of the theory of Poisson manifolds, how to define a Poisson structure in the space of these difference operators. This is a non-trivial generalization of, one can say, of the Virasoro algebra. It's a lattice, at least a lattice version of the Virasoro algebra under some special restrictions. How can we just define this Poisson structure with good covariance properties? Just let's define left derivatives and right derivatives of a function just using left translations and right translations respectively. So this gives you two sets of gradients, left gradients and right gradients. And then you can just define the Poisson bracket just by combining these left gradients with each other and right gradients with each other. This is the so-called affine Poisson structure, naturally defined on this space of wave functions, which is nothing but a principal homogeneous space for the group of translations acting on the left and for another copy which acts on the right. And this same formula can be also written in this tensor form using the kernels of these two operators L and R. So it's an equivalent formula, but just I reproduce it for historical reasons. And this is a Poisson action. If we just look at this left bracket, then left translations, they define Poisson action, where the group of left translations is itself a Poissonly group associated with this left R matrix. And the same thing for the right R matrix. So this is a natural thing to do, but the question is how to explain the choice. Just so far, we have two free parameters, two arbitrary operators, L and R, which can be used to define something natural, but we can just do, we have to also do just to keep track of the Jacob identity, and this is assured by the so-called quasi-classical Young-Baxter equation, which has to be satisfied by L and by R. This is a standard part of the story. If we just look at what we get, so we must, this was defined for psi, and now we must look for L. And do we get something reasonable for L? Now, the two contributions of left and right R matrices can be computed independently. Here's what we get in the contribution of L. This is not a very transparent formula, but it is not satisfactory because in itself it doesn't satisfy the Jacob identity. The Jacob identity can only be saved by combination of the two, of the left and of the right. And the right R matrix now, it appears just to be something impossible because our function, this this combination, it is not invariant with respect to the right action, with respect to right translations. And if we just try to eliminate this thing, then the right bracket in general the contribution of R, it just gives you a wrong formula. If you just consider this thing, then the right hand side doesn't depend on this combination, which we need to preserve, this combination, which is psi tau, psi to the minus one. We get a complicated formula which depends on psi itself. And it's only possible just to make it consistent if this adjoint psi operator disappears from the final formula. Now it happens that it can be done in a very unique and elementary way. This R matrix has to be nothing but the Cayley transform of this automorphism tau. This is a correct and unique answer. And then, if with this unique choice, we get finally the correct formula on the level of potentials. We get a nice formula with two contributions. One contribution comes from the left matrix, and another one comes from this Cayley transform. And this Cayley R matrix is also satisfied by the classical Young-Baxter equation, so it's okay. But there is one caution. Everything is good, but this R matrix is not everywhere defined, because the automorphism tau has fixed points, and these fixed points are nothing but the quasi-constants. So we have a good R matrix, but it is just defined on a subspace, which is complementary to the space of quasi-constants. And this is the real source of the trouble. We can also here it's explained that we can do in a similar way when we have several automorphisms. For example, we are working on a multi-dimensional lattice. Is it just possible to do in a similar way? The answer is yes. And this R matrix is just provided by this formula, and the necessary cancellations, they come from the standard Hilbert identity. And now comes the question. Just let me skip a few slides, just to remain to this, to return to this R matrix, the R matrix R, which has to be regularized. For example, in the case of translations on the line of this formula, for the translation, this Cayley transform is an integral operator given by this explicit formula. It's just we take the Fourier transform of f, this is f hat, and the kernel is cotangent, and it's of course a singular integral operator, and we have to regularize it. And it's the regularization of this integral operator, which introduces into play this R matrix, this finite dimensional R matrix, living on the space of zero modes for this Fourier transform, and it's this regularization that is responsible broken symmetry. We have realized that it's the only way to define the right R matrix by means of this Cayley transform, because it kills all obstructions. But this Cayley transform isn't flawless because of this problem with Fourier zero modes. And then we have to regularize it. And here comes this regularization R matrix R naught, which is acting just in the space of quasi-constants. Same thing also applies in the elliptic case. In the elliptic case, you also get a nice explicit formula for this R matrix in terms of some series, which essentially Fourier, it's essentially a Fourier series for Jacobi theta 1 function. And finally, again, comes the question, this little r, how can it be chosen? So far, it's an arbitrary finite dimensional R matrix, which is used to regularize our singular integral operator, but in itself, it remains so far arbitrary. Now, we must, just to fix up everything, just to get an absolutely rigid model, we must restrict it a little bit further. And instead of speaking of abstract first-order difference operator, I finally come up to study nth-order difference operator, scalar difference operator, which is just of this form. Let me... So we have a scalar function phi, which satisfies this nth-order difference equation. The theory of such difference equations, it's again a matter of difference version of Dirichlet-Sakharov theory, and this time it appears to be quite non-trivial. In the original setting of Dirichlet and Sakharov, they just the modest, the classical thing that you can just write a matrix psi prime is equal to 0, 1, u, 0, psi. This is the matrix form of the second order differential equation, this one in the upper corner of a 2x2 matrix. Now this one is something very peculiar. It's a principal and important element in the Lie algebra of SL2. And fixing this principal and important element means imposing a constraint on our 2x2 matrix. And this constraint, in fact, it arises naturally in the course of Hamiltonian reduction. We can consider matrices of this kind, one and anything here, and then we have to take the quotient of this manifold over the group of lower triangular matrices, and this is an example, a beautiful example of Hamiltonian reduction with respect to this triangular group. And the quotient space is naturally identified with the space of second order differential operators, and it inherits the quotient Poisson structure. This is the Dirichlet-Sakharov theory. Now, in difference case, we have this kind of equation. It's 0, 1, minus 1. U psi. This time here this potential has zero trace, and here the potential itself is a group element and has determinant 1. And we have this matrix which is what has 1 and minus 1. Unlike this case where it's a principal and important element, this time it's a semi-simple matrix. And it's nothing but the Coxeter element. It's an element which represents the Coxeter reflection in the Cartan algebra. And this rule of the Coxeter element is in fact crucial. This is again a kind of constraint which we impose on our system, which explicitly takes into account this non-trivial rule of the Coxeter element, which replaces the non-trivial role of the principal and important element. And this constraint is non-trivial. Everything goes, it would be a catastrophe because the Poisson bracket for these constraints, they are what is called by Dirac second class, which means that if we just simply impose this constraint, it's inconsistent. So it would be an absolute catastrophe, and the theory would be inconsistent, be it not for the ultimate
remedy which we can find. And this remedy is the choice of the R metrics. There exists...
Use Dirac reduction.
Yes, no. The Dirac reduction is possible to use, but then it will change us the space, the quotient space will be changed, because we shall remove one variable, and for each constraint we remove a variable and a conjugate variable, and this will be wrong. So the only way to save oneself is just to make all constraints first class, and miraculously this is possible. Again, this is possible if we choose this R matrix. This is the R matrix which we need. This is the R matrix. It's again the Kelly transform of this outermost of tau combined with the reflection associated with the Coxeter element. And this is the miraculous form which saves everything. And so finally, in this situation, we can fix almost everything. We fix this little r by recognizing the key role of this Coxeter element, and then we can also fix the left R matrix, which was remained free so far, to account for the good properties of the monodromy matrix. So finally, after a sequence of choices which have to be made by hand, but which were completely rigid, if you want to get something reasonable, you have absolutely no freedom. And so finally, you get a set of very natural formula, and finally the difference Galois group in the situation again becomes the Poisson the group with the R matrix R naught. It is P plus minus P minus plus this 1 minus S 1 plus R S P naught. As a linear operator, it's organized as this way. So we have decomposition G equal to N plus N minus plus H. This is the standard decomposition of the Lie algebra. Upper triangular part, lower triangular part, and the Cartan subalgebra. And then your R matrix is a linear operator. It acts as a projection onto N plus, minus a projection onto N minus in this decomposition, plus this fancy Kelly transform of the Coxeter element. We take this. I must distinguish the Coxeter element itself, which is a n by n matrix, with the reflection operator induced by this Kelly Coxeter element in the Cartan algebra. And this is the answer. In SO2 case, this disappears. For SO2...
What does it mean? What's the... It is 1 plus R.
1 plus RS. It is...
The denominator 1 plus minus.
It's minus, of course. For SO2, S is equal to minus 1. And so this contribution disappears. So this contribution is indeed important starting from SO3. For SO2, it's just 0. Well, just you can. It depends on the exponents of the algebra. You must take the spectral decomposition of this Coxeter reflection is associated with the exponents of the algebra. It's a tabular thing. Just for each simple Lie algebra, we have a set of exponents, and just in terms of these exponents, in terms of some corresponding projection operator, you just get the full spectral decomposition of your R matrix. This is a non-trivial thing, which is not quite well known. It also has its repercussions in the theory of quantum groups, in the theory of ordinary and simply algebras. You have these Newportian elements, principal Newportian elements. You have characters. Your algebra N plus has a non-degenerate character associated with the opposite Newportian element. If you look at the quantum algebra generated by the set of the same set of generators and this famous Dreyfus-Jimber relations, then the Newportian subalgebra doesn't have any non-trivial character. And this is a big flaw, which has to be compensated. And this is the way to compensate it, just one of the several slightly different but equivalent ways just to compensate for this absence of non-trivial principal Newportian elements of non-trivial characters of the quantized Newportian algebra. Just the several relations, they are complicated and just they exclude the trivial solution. And so finally, just let me sum up. We have just I have just dressed the way to do it in a more or less canonical way. We must resolve several difficulties, but they are resolved just in a very rigid way. And finally, the space of scalar difference operators on the line or in the partition plane, it's equipped with a natural Poisson structure, which is non-trivial, and which takes into account all the subtleties, including the Coxeter element and the exponents of our algebra. And as a result, the group, the difference Galois group, again becomes a Poisson Lie group associated with this correctly chosen classical R matrix. And of course, we can, if you just look at the associated nonlinear difference equations, then we shall have the same tower, which has been explicitly described for KdV case. It also exists in other cases, and all intermediate difference fields, they will be equipped with their respective Poisson brackets and all arrows, just all. The picture will be tremendously complicated, but it will remain largely the same as in this simple KdV case. Well, that's the end of the story so far. There is one more thing, just what I do not know how to do. There is another famous story about the space of differential operators which live on a Riemann surface. So this is the Gordon bracket, which lives on the level of potentials, of quadratic differentials on the Riemann surface. And again, it's a good question how to extend this bracket to the space of sections, which are spinners living on that same surface. There should be an explicit formula, I don't know it. It's an open question, and I just recommend it to the attention of everybody who is interested in meromorphic functions on Riemann surfaces.
Thank you very much. Given that we have slightly longer break, maybe we have time for one or two quick questions and then defer the other ones to the break. Yeah.
So there was a lot of things mixed against, and it was kind of cool. But let me just, because of a classical quantum, then you went to Riemann surfaces. But let me just stick to the classical.
Yes.
So first we talk about KdV and this equation is obtained from SL2 by the increase of operator. But then you can take SLN. Then you get this Gelfand-Dicke hierarchy, including W algebra and so on. Do you have this kind of stuff?
Yes.
In this case?
Yes.
And also for any simple algebra.
For any simple algebra.
For the Dreyfus-Sokolov reduction, for any simple algebra. But then the hierarchy becomes much larger.
And the formula becomes complicated. And this
And it is published already.
It's published. It's the Esotokase is published in my paper with Jan Marshall in CMP in 208, and the general case and this lattice case and this Kelly transform, etc. It's published in my paper in Journal of Theoretical and Mathematical Physics. It's in Russian, but it's translated into English as well, so it's available.
What is the German?
TMF.
It's
2015, I guess.
And also, you said that you have some stuff in the quantum case. When the
well, I also refer to this non-trivial extension of the Dünnfeld-Sokolov theory to the difference case, and that's a relatively old stuff. This has been done by Richard Tichin, Igor Frankl and me in the SO2 case, and by Sebastianov and myself in the general case, and that was in 1998 or something like that. And then the addition, which has to be taken into account, is just this extension, this lift of the Poisson structure, which takes into account this the subtleties to the space of wave functions. This is another story.
And the lift you have for any simple reaction?
Yes.
Or only, not only for the simple?
Yes.
Again, and we have a longer break after this. I think it's 3:40. Yeah, 3:40.